Hello friend, this is Dr. Sangeeta from Dental Pachwala, where we help you understand and learn dentistry better and easy way. And till now we have covered the furcation defects, the defects which are occurring at the furcation, at the bifurcation, close to the root trunk. Now if there is a bone loss which is closer to the root trunk, we have already covered all the furcation defects, and also we have covered the Glickman classification. So the grade 1 classification, according to that, there is a supra bony pocket, so there is no penetration of the probe, and also we cannot see the radiograph because that is the initial defect. And after that, the second grade is all about the penetration, when there is a penetration of the probe but we cannot see the probe from the other end. So that would be a class 2 Glickman's grade 2 classification of the furcation defect. And class 3 is when there is a soft tissue lining. So when there is a soft tissue covering the bone defect but there is no bone interdentally. So when we pass the probe, we cannot pass the probe. Can you see passing the probe? No, you can't see. So the class 4 Glickman defect is when the furcation, there is a adfurcation defect and there is also no bone and there is also no soft tissue, so you can see a tunnel. So if you can see a tunnel and that probe can be easily passed. So today's video we are going to talk about the treatment of the furcation defects. So without further ado, let's jump into it. So guys, before we get started, make sure you subscribe to our channel and click on the bell icon. That way you get a notification as soon as I release a video lecture. Now coming to the treatment of the furcation. Furcation, we have already covered the Glickman classification. We have four grades. The first grade is when there is an initial or the early lesion, or we can say the incipient lesion. In that case, we have a supra bony pocket and there is no penetration of the probe. While there is no penetration of the probe and there is no radiographic change, so when we look at the radiograph of the grade 1 furcation involvement, we cannot see any changes in the radiograph. There is very slight interradicular bone loss. And grade 2 furcation we have covered, that is the cul-de-sac lesion with the definitive horizontal component. And when once we pass the probe, we cannot see the probe from the other end. So the other end is closed. Bone loss occurs only in the one side. So either it can be a palatal or it can be a buccal. So there is a partial penetration of the probe. And also we have covered the modification of the Glickman classification. So grade 2, they have two modifications. So the modification include grade 2 degree 1 and grade 2 degree 2. So grade 2 degree 1, basically these are the vertical components. Because all of the horizontal, all of the Glickman classification is basically a horizontal component. So the vertical component is included in the modification of the Glickman classification, which is the grade degree 1 is the vertical component within ranging from 1 to 3 millimeters. And if it is more than 3 millimeter of vertical involvement, then it is a grade 2 and degree 2 classification. Now next one we have is the grade 3. Now grade 3 is where there is no bone present at the interradicular area but there is a soft tissue covering, so there is no penetration of the probe. And radiograph, once we look at the radiograph, see clinically, because there is a soft tissue covering, so we cannot see the furcation. But if we look at the radiograph, then there is a radiolucency which is present at the furcation area. And grade 4, where is the tunnel exists between the roots and there is a through and through penetration, so we can see the probe from the other end. So this is about the Glickman classification. So today's video we are going to talk about the furcation treatment. Now if we talk about the grade 1 furcation, that is grade 1 furcation is very slight furcation because this is just the incipient lesion, so it can be treated with the scaling and the root planning procedure. So if you want to do the scaling and the root planning procedure, either you can do the scaling and the root planning procedure, or if you have a class 1 grade 1 and grade 2, in that shallow grade 2 if we have, then also we can do the odontoplast and the osteoplast. Now talking about the scaling and the root planning procedure. So the most common teeth involved in the furcation is the maxillary or the mandibular buccal class 2 furcation area, which is the most common involved. And next to that, other than that, is the mesiodistal mesial, either mesial or distal maxillary class 2 furcation. And the least furcation which we can see is the class 3 defects. Class 3 defects are, or class 4 defects are, very least seen defects. If we talk about class 1 defects, see class 1 defect is just the initial defect, so it can be treated with a non-surgical approach. And if we talk about the shallow grade 2, that also can be treated with the non-surgical approach. And the non-surgical approach, we can just do the scaling and the root planning. So we are Excuse me, we are doing the scaling and the route planning procedure. If we are going for the deep class 2s, deep grade 2s, as well as grade 3 or grade 4 vacation, then we have to do it surgically, because otherwise there is no other option that we can treat all of these vacation, because they are so intensive, they are so deep. So talking about the scaling and the route plan, which is a non-surgical approach, and scaling and route, there is an obliteration of the vacation area. So either you can do the restorative, which we'll cover later on. So first thing we do the scaling and route planning, not only for the grade 1, but also for grade 2, grade 3, grade 4, grade 5, and grade 4, I mean. So whatever grade is the vacation involvement. I have been telling you this from since day 1 of the perio lectures, that if you want to do any surgical approach in the perio, the first thing you need to do is do the scaling and the route planning procedures, because it is going to resolve all of the inflammatory responses, because once we remove the plaque, there is going to be a subside in the inflammation. So we can use this non-surgical scaling and route planning approach for class 1, or as well as for the shallow class 2 defect or the cul-de-sac lesions. Cul-de-sac lesion is the grade 2, because it is like an open tunnel. So this, there is one end of the tunnel, but there is dead end at the other end, because like the, we penetrate the probe and we cannot see it from the other side, so we call it the cul-de-sac lesion. So basically, after doing the scaling and the route planning procedure, there is going to be a normal healing process, and in response to this healing process, there is going to be again the attachment at the focation area, which can be seen, but not in the extensive defects. Only in the superficial defects, if we talk about the shallow class 2 or the grade 1 defects. So treatment of, it can be also a treatment of choice for the medically compromised, as well as for the patient in whom we cannot do the surgical procedure, in whom we cannot do the major surgeries. So in that, we only do the scaling and the route planning, because we can't do other than that. Because if surgery is avoided, then this is the best approach, doing the scaling and the route planning. And also scaling and the route planning procedure is going, you are going to do it at the first approach. So as soon as you are planning for any surgery, either it is a grade 1, grade 2, any grade it is, or either it is a pocket, you are going to do the scaling and the route planning at the first. This is the first approach. And also, if you do scaling and route planning, it can also resolve the class 1 or the grade 1 defect, as well as the shallow grade 2 defects. So scaling and route planning, basically you are going to do the curettage of the root area, curettage of the furcation area. But you know, the difficult thing about the furcation is that while you are doing the scaling and the root planning, when once you know the concavities and all the surfaces of the teeth, it is actually very difficult to do the scaling and the root planning. So we have some special kind of curettes which are used only for the furcation defect, because otherwise the normal curette cannot go into the furcation. So for that, we have some specially designed curettes. So the first one we have is the DeMarco furcation curette, and also we have the Quitin furcation curette. Now these Quitin furcation curette are of two types. Now it can be either BL1 and BL2. This is based on the tips width. So based on the diameter, the blade width, it comes in the two variants, the blade 1 and the blade 1. So blade 2. So Quitin curettes, these are the half moon shaped. Can you see, these are the half moon shaped curettes, and because they can go deep into the furcation area, into the floor of the furcation, and also they can go into the developmental depressions. So they have the better access. They have the better access to reach to the furcation. That is why we are using these Quitin curette for the furcation defects. So these are, they come in the two types, based on the tip width, the smaller one and the larger one, or the wider one. The smaller one is the BL1 and MD1. So the blade width of BL1 is, the diameter blade width is 0.9 millimeter, and for BL2, which is the blade width to the larger one, so it has a blade width of 1.3 millimeters. But see, if you see the molars, if you see the upper and lower molars, so 58% of the molars, they have the entrance diameter. We have already talked about this in the furcation itself. So 58% of the upper and lower molars have the furcation entrance diameter less than 0.75. So these furcation curettes are not going to work, because they are not going, if we are talking about the narrow, the conventional curettes, so they won't go, because it is too narrow for these curettes. So here comes the ultrasonic scalar tips. The ultrasonic scalar tips are actually, they are given by the Oda and Ishikawa. So these scalar tips, they are made up of a specific special designed acid resistant stainless steel. So these are the ultrasonic scalar tips, which has a ball or sphere at the end, at the tip, and with a diameter of 0.8 millimeters, and they protect the root surface and the soft tissue injuries, because they are only going to contact with the specific area at the focation area and the tip. See, the tip is kind of a spiral with a radius of the curvature of 9 millimeters. So basically they rotate in clockwise as well as in the anti-clockwise direction. So there comes the ultrasonic tips used for the narrow focation defects, because they can go easily anywhere they want to go. See, the first thing you are doing is the scaling and the root planning procedure. After that, what else can you do for only the minor involvement at the focation? That is, if we are talking about the grade 1. So there is very initial defect, right? And not even visible in the radiograph. So when there is very initial defect, then you can put some restorative material and close the defect. Now this is practically not very good option, because it is not so successful. So initially there was used a ZOE cement, but there was seen a progressive bone loss around the ZOE, and there was also increased plaque accumulation around the ZOE. So if we fill this focation with a ZOE, it is not successful. Then some guy or some author or some discoverer, some dentist, he used the silver amalgam. So what he noticed after using the silver amalgam, after 1 year there was a radiolucency at the base of the restoration. So that also cannot be used. Then there comes the GIC restoration. So GIC restoration is actually a very effective occlusal barrier, and it has been used by Ruddy KP and in 2005, and it is used for class 3 focation defects, and this is kind of a good approach because this is successful, but not good as we compare with the other approaches. So also you can use the restorative material to seal the focation area for the initial focation defects. So next come for the class 1 or the shallow defects is the odontoplasty. Now as the name suggests, odonto means tooth, plasty means you are shaping. So every time I have been telling you this, thus plasty means the kind of a plastic surgery, related to the plastic surgery. So you are giving a new shape. So it is the reshaping of the tooth. Basically what happens is, you are going to reshape the coronal part of the furcation. Now why are you doing this? Because there is very small defect, and you are going to widen the entrance of the furca, and this is going to decrease the horizontal depth of the furcation, mainly, which is sufficient for the grade 1. And most of the times you can use this, you can shape the area close to the furcation for also for the class 2 shallow defects. But it has also complications, because if you are going to shape the tooth, then there is going to be a sensitivity, and there can be a pulpal irritation also. Or if you are doing it too much, there can be pulpal exposure. If you are doing it going, so you can reach up to the pulp also. And whenever you are touching any root surface, cemental surface, there are high chances that you are going to cause the root caries by yourself. So this was about the odontoplasty. So next option for class 1 or shallow class 2 defect we have is the osteoplasty. Now we have two terms. The first one is the osteoplasty. We have already covered this if you are watching all of the videos. And the next term is the osteectomy. So osteectomy means we are removing the bone. We are reshaping and removing the supporting bone. Now bone, both of them we are removing the bone. But the main difference is that plasty, where we are doing plasty, we are not touching any of the bone which is adjacent to tooth structure. That means any of the bone which is adjacent to our PDL. And osteectomy means shaping and removing of the supporting bone. So osteoplasty, we are basically doing reshaping the bone surfaces that are not touching the tooth, that are not the supporting bone. So if we are doing this osteoplasty, if we are removing the bone which is close to the furcation defect, so what we are doing, we are creating a ramp through the furcation, and that is going to change the lip of the defect. So there is going to be a decrease in the horizontal defect. This is going to decrease the horizontal defect, and when we are apically positioning the flap, there is going to be decrease in the pocket depth. Also the patient has got access to clean the area. So you can also make the tunnel, which we will talk about in the tunneling week. You can also make the tunnel in which the patient can use the interproximal brushes and clean the area. So that is how you are improving the plaque control, because you are not letting the plaque accumulate. So the next one we have is the Furcation plasty, which I have not mentioned. So Furcation plasty is basically the combination of both of these. So you are removing the bone, you are removing the tooth structure at the furcation area. That is the Furcation plasty. So combination of those, both of them is known as Furcation plasty, which is near to the furcation area. So this is the Furcation plasty. When first of all you are elevating the flap, you are doing the curettage, removing all of the granulation tissue, then you are doing the odontoplasty as well as the osteoplasty. So after doing this, you are cleaning again and you are doing the debridement, and then again pulling back the flap again. Either it can be apically or it can be undisplaced flap. So basically depend on the treatment option you are doing. But most of the time for furcation, we do the apically displaced flap. See, next come the root resectioning. This we have covered, first elevating the flap, do the osteoplasty, do the odontoplasty, which we call the Furcation plasty. Somehow it can also in the initial deep plasto defect, it is helpful. So the next come is the root resection. Now root resection is sectioning the root. So you are just removing one of the roots. So like this, suppose this is a maxillary molar with a palatal root, right? So suppose this area, there is a defect. So you are going to remove this root. Only a portion of the root is removed. Only one root out of all the roots, only one root is removed. So this is, so the structures become like this. So this is the root resectioning. When you are doing this root resectioning or the root amputation, you are removing just the affected root. The root which is involved in the furcation, the most involved root, we are removing the root. And while you are doing this root resectioning procedure, because you are removing the root, so the first important thing to do is doing a root canal treatment, so that there is no pain to the patient, there is no trauma to the patient, so that you are doing a safely procedure. So the first thing you do is root canal treatment, and next thing is you are doing the apically positioned flap. Basically you are making a window in the bone, right, to get access to the root. So after doing the root canal, you are doing the surgical phase, in which you are apically positioning the flap. So you are taking the flap back towards the roots and you are doing the bone recontouring. After you do the bone recontouring, after you remove the root, then there comes the restorative procedure or prosto part. So first thing is to maintain the biological width, and you do a crown. You make a crown because you have done the root canal treatment. So you prepare a crown for a patient and you give the knife edge ridge in case of a root resectioning procedure. Now important thing is which root to remove. The one which is most affected is should be removed. The one which is involved with the furcation, the one which has the maximum attachment loss, the one which is making harm to other root, other tooth also, and other roots also. So suppose if somebody is affecting the local neighboring root, like the, or if it is spreading the infection to the adjacent root, and the root which has the most unfavorable root morphology. So because this root has a poor prognosis, so that is the root to be removed. So most of the times, the one which is involved with the most commonly involved with the furcation, most commonly involved with the attachment loss, that root is to be removed in the root resection or the root amputation procedure. And you are going to give a cut in the oblique direction. Have you seen? I have not given in the horizontal direction. I have given in the oblique direction. Because earlier the concept was to preserve the pulp chamber, because we don't want to affect the pulp chamber. So in order to do that, in order to maintain the pulp chamber, because suppose the pulp chamber was like this, right? Earlier, right? So like that. So in order to just preserve the pulp chamber, you are giving an oblique direction. And if you are doing root canal treatment, it doesn't matter. If we are talking about the vital tooth structure, then we are giving the oblique cut. But if you have done the root canal treatment or the tooth is non-vital, then you can also do the horizontal incision. Basically, after the surgery, while doing the surgery, you are going to create a window at the specific root which you want to remove. You are going to give the oblique cut and just remove the root. And this is all done after doing the root canal treatment. Don't forget to do the root canal treatment first. Now the most commonly tooth, which is most commonly root or tooth which is resected, Here are maxillary molars. See, you have to, I will tell you about hemisection also. So, root recession, because I have made a maxillary diagram. So, remember this, because the root resection is most commonly done in the maxillary teeth. And hemisection or bicuspidization is most commonly done in the mandibular teeth. Now, how will you remember this? How I have remembered is hemisection means cutting into half. So, the mandibular molars, because they have two roots. So, half, that means both the sides are equal. Or bicuspidization. Bi means two. Hemi means two. So, like that, if there are, we are talking about two roots, because two roots are present in the mandibular molars. So, hemisection or bicuspidization, we are going to do in the two, in the mandibular molars. And root resectioning, that means we are removing one root. So, what makes it equal? If we are talking about three root and if we remove one root, it becomes the two. So, this is done in the maxillary molars. So, most commonly root which is resected in the in the maxillary molar is the distobuccal root. And that is why I will remove the distobuccal root only. So, when do we remove this root? When do we do this root resectioning? When there is the maximum attachment loss which is confined to one root. If it is confined all over, then there is no use of doing the root resection. This is the obvious thing. So, if you are going to do a root resectioning procedure, that means only one root is going to be affected a lot. That is why if you remove this one root, then there is going to be a good prognosis. There is going to be a good chances of furcation in treatment. So, if there is a grade 2 or grade 3 furcation, if there is a dehiscence, if there is a root perforation related to this root, if there is a fracture, if there is a root caries or any violation of the biological width, when we don't do this procedure, when this root resectioning is contraindicated, first of all of the surgical procedure are contraindicated when the patient is having a poor oral hygiene. And in perio, it is very important for the patient to keep a good oral hygiene, because if patient is not maintaining a oral hygiene, so whatever treatment we are doing, it is going into the gutter. So there is no use of doing any treatment if the patient is not maintaining the oral hygiene. So the first thing is, when there is a poor oral hygiene, it is contraindicated. And when we can't do this root resectioning, when there is a fused root, for example, third molar if you are talking about. So the fused root, because these roots are fused and it is difficult to remove one of the roots, so we cannot do this root resectioning procedure in the fused roots. So the next one we have is the hemisection. Now both, all of these terms are different. Hemi means half, right? Sectioning means we are sectioning. So hemisection is, we are removing the tooth as well as the root into two parts, right? So this is like a divide and rule policy from now on. So divide and rule, breaking into two parts and removing the one which is most diseased. See, bicuspidization means making two cusps. Okay, so bicuspidization, we are keeping both of these roots and giving crown to both of these roots. So bicuspidization would be, after bicuspidization, it is going to be like this, and we are giving the crown. So this is a bicuspidization. So both of the portions of the root we are keeping and using as the abutment, because unity is the power. So bicuspidization, they believe in the unity, and hemisectioning, they believe in the divide and the rule policy. So whatever most infected part of the tooth as well as the root is resected, it is removed, and which is usually done in the mandibular teeth, and the good root is kept, the bad root is kept away, is removed. So this is the divide and rule policy. And because we are talking about, see, if you want to divide the tooth, so if you are doing the hemisectioning procedure, you are going to divide in the mesiodistal direction. Okay, and root separation or the bicuspidization is, you are keeping both of the portions of, you are just dividing it and keeping both of them. So both roots are kept, both crowns are kept and used as the abutment. Also, we can do the GTR regenerative procedures. GTR we have already covered, guided tissue regeneration, in which we are guiding the tissues, specific tissues to grow, and we are making, that is the PDL. And we are creating a barrier as a membrane, and we are not letting the healing meet the bone epithelial or the connective tissue. Only the PDL cells, we are letting the PDL cells to grow, and there is a regeneration of the lowest connective tissue attachment from the PDL cells. So GTR is a membrane which acts as a barrier for the PDL cells to grow, and not letting the bone epithelial or connective tissue to meet GTR we have already covered. If you haven't watched the video, please go and watch the video because there is a story in the GTR. Now we are talking about the tunneling. Tunneling is a procedure wherein we are making a tunnel. So here the funda is, if the furcation defect is grade 3, then convert it to grade 4. Because anyhow, the bone loss exists in grade 3, right? That is why we have been discussing the Glickman's classification a lot. So this is the grade 3 classification, wherein there is a resorption of the bone occurring at the furcation area. But there is a soft tissue coverage. So we are displacing the flap apically and then we are making this tunnel a open tunnel, like through and through, like this, like that exists in the class 4, so that the patient can clean this area. If it is covered, then there is more of the plaque which is accumulating, more of the infection which is spreading, and there is a poor prognosis. So we are just making this tunnel visible in the oral cavity so that the patient can use the interproximal brushes and there is less plaque accumulation, so that the patient can maintain it easily by using the interproximal brushes. And we guide the patient, we tell the patient to use, how to use these interproximal brushes and keep this area clean. So converting the class 3 defect into class 2 defect by the tunneling procedure, we are making a tunnel like how it exists in the class 4 or grade 4 defects. And the last resort is extraction. If nothing is possible, nothing is working, then the only last hope is to go for the tooth extraction. So also we can do the regenerative procedure like the host modulation we have covered. If you haven't watched the video, that is a really nice video. I just love reading the host modulation, and this concept is like a really nice concept. So in that we have studied the enamel derived protein. So if you remember, we have studied the enamel derived proteins, which are the endogain. So these endogains, they contain the amelogenin. Now this amelogenin is basically composed of the Hertwig epithelial root sheath, which forms the acellular cementum. So if you can also, for the regenerative procedure, if you want to regrow or regenerate the tissues, then we use this endogain. So you can use this enamel derivative protein, which is a host modulating agent. Also sometimes bone graft is used at the area of the furcation, that is also regenerative, along with the PRF or PRP procedure, which is the platelet rich plasma. Now we take this blood sample from the patient and then we put it in the centrifuge machine. In that we get a concentrated plasma with a platelet which contains the growth factor. Now the clot which is formed after the centrifugation acts as the scaffold where we want the growth to occur, and we put that, the plasma rich PRF, into the site, and then there is a regeneration process which occurs. So this is about the treatment of the furcation. And to brush it up, the class 1 defect. Class 1 early defect is the initial defect, incipient furcation defect, and because the pocket is supra bony, so because it has not entered the furcation area yet, so we can do the scaling and the root planning procedure, which is effective. And any thick overhanging margin restoration, facial grooves, or any cervical enamel projection if present, we have already talked about in the furcation. Then we recontour it, we clean the surface area. If there is cervical enamel projection present, then we remove it. So this is the odontoplasty, or if you are replacing it, either if odontoplasty is required, you do odontoplasty. If osteoplasty is required, you do the osteoplasty, because these procedures are actually sufficient to restore the periodontal health, because there is going to be a resolution in the inflammation, because this is not a very huge defect. So if we remove the plaque, there is a reduction or the resolution in the inflammation, and there is a repair of the PDL automatically because there is less defect, it can heal. So scaling and root planning procedure is sufficient for the class 1 defect. If we talk about the class 2 defect, now if the shallow class 2, shallow horizontal defect are present without the significant vertical bone loss, it will respond well to the localized flap procedure, flap along with the osteoplasty and odontoplasty, which we call it the furcation plasty. So these are, if there are deep defects which are present, isolated deep defects, then we have to go for the flap, odontoplasty, osteoplasty procedure, because this will decrease the dome of the furcation and this will alter the gingival card contours and facilitate the patient to remove the plaque, as well as for keeping the area clean. We are talking about the advanced class 2 defect. Then we have to go for the root resectioning, in which we remove one root. Root resectioning is not this. Root resectioning is this, which we do it in the maxillary teeth. So in which we, first of all, we treat the tooth, the RCT treated. First of all, the treat should be RCT treated, and after that we remove the one root. Now this is mostly done in the maxillary molars, and after, if there is a, if also we can do the hemisection, bicuspidization, as well as the root separation, which is the splitting of the root into two and separating it. Now in the hemisection we remove the root, in bicuspidization we keep the root as well as the crown, and we use it as the abutment. So both the parts are kept for the prosthetic purpose, and hemisectioning, bicuspidization, root separation, so these are done in the mandibular molar, especially when there is a buccal or lingual class 2 or class 3 furcation defect is present. And you are going to do the GTR regenerative procedure. We have the GTR, we have host modulating agent, in that we have Emdogain, and also we have the PRF, PRP, and the bone. So you can also put the bone grafts. So if you are going talking about the class 3 defect, you can create a tunnel making the class 3 to class 4. Also you can do the root resectioning, and the last resort is the tooth extraction. When nothing works, then the last resort is you finally have to extract the tooth. So my dear friends, this is about the furcation treatment. We have already covered the furcation defects, and if you enjoy watching our channel, enjoy watching our video, then subscribe it and share it with your friends so that the others can also learn. And if you feel that you have learned something new today, or I have made it easier for you to understand, then go ahead and hit the comment box and the like button, because this helped me to help you skyrocket your career and knowledge while you stay at home with your family.